Hi everyone, Zoe here, and before I forget, I want to do a quick shout out to the two people who've been nice enough to support the channel through Patreon. So Ben and Catherine Ann, thank you very much, I really appreciate it. And if anyone else who's watching this enjoys the content I put out and can afford to pitch in a little bit during these quarantine times, I wouldn't say no. So thank you in advance if you decide to help in any way. There are links down in the video description for, you know, support options. But anyway, moving on to today's topic, I've been working on another video on democracy, and that'll be fun and rantalicious, so you should keep an eye out for that to drop maybe later in the week. But I did look at the calendar, and I saw yesterday was the 16th annual International Day Against Homophobia, Transphobia, and Biphobia. And I suppose if you've never experienced personally discrimination or abuse on the basis of your sexual orientation or your gender identity, you might be forgiven for assuming that maybe we no longer need days like this. But spoilers, yes, we really do. I mean, if you watch the TV and you see, like, pride marches televised and you see celebrities coming out as gay and their careers carry on, and you know that there are certain sectors of industry and certain cosmopolitan localities where queer people, the queer clientele, are sought and welcomed and, you know, greeted just like everybody else, which shouldn't be shocking and amazing, but sadly we have to celebrate what we can. Yeah, you might be forgiven for thinking that things have come along so well that there's not really any reason to bang the drums about protecting the rights of LGBT folk, especially if you happen to live in one of these countries where they've actually passed legislation to prevent LGBT citizens from being discriminated against. But what you have to remember when you take all these little disparate pieces of evidence and try and form a worldview of, like, how well off LGBT people are, is that you're looking at little enclaves of tolerance in a sea of hostility. Most of the world is not that happy about the fact that LGBT people exist and shows it at every opportunity they can, up to the limit of the law, basically. So yeah, my thesis for this video, before I go rabbiting on for another 10 minutes, is basically that if you become an active ally to LGBT plus people, you're not just helping them, you're helping yourself, you're helping your loved ones, you're helping your community, and you're helping society as a whole. And I'll explain how that all falls out over the course of the video. But yeah, this is what I'd like to do, just to encourage people to take it a bit more seriously, because at the moment, in the UK where I live, yeah, in the middle of a pandemic crisis, our incompetent government, who's totally bungled its response to COVID-19, has decided that it's sufficiently distracting that they might be able to sneak in and dismantle some rights and protections for transgender people. And so there's a lot of people like myself who are watching this, obviously also protesting and actively trying to stop these moves, but worrying about what our legal status might be a year or two from now if the changes that the Tories are trying to sneak through actually get passed into law. Basically, it amounts to repealing things like bits of the Equality Act, which was passed back in 2010. So if you assume that once rights have been established for LGBT people, that it's job done, you're fooling yourself, because it's not like any of this is chiseled in stone. These rights can be rolled back just as easily as they, well, a lot more easily than they came in. And that's the problem, is as a species, certainly as a civilization and societies, we've been fighting for centuries, and then the last few decades in particular, to establish civil liberties, privacy protections, human rights for broader and broader groups of people, because honestly, it should apply to everyone on the planet. And all it takes is a turn in public opinion, or a government coming into power that is run by demagogues and people who have really no concern for the welfare of the people, and these rights can be taken away. And if we don't all stand together to stop that from happening, it won't just be LGBT people who lose their rights. So please take this seriously. But yeah, let's see, this got serious fast, so maybe I'll back up a bit and let's start with a fun fact. The International Day Against Homophobia, Transphobia, and Biphobia, I know it just rolls off the tongue, right? It's observed every 17th of May, because it was on that date back in 1990 that the World Health Organization finally decided that homosexuality could be removed from its international classification of diseases. So yeah, let's just let that sink in for a moment. This means that as recently as 30 years ago, homosexuality was considered a health disorder by the WHO. Reality check. Having same-sex attraction has zero intrinsic impact upon your health, one way or the other. I mean, being queer is only dangerous to one's health because society permits and often tacitly encourages homophobia and homophobic reprisals. So yeah, I mean, hopefully it's obvious that any society or culture that that sends this message, either through the predominant media or through the dominant politics of the time, that LGBT plus individuals are inherently lesser than cisgender heterosexuals, obviously gives a ton of hate groups the green light to attack us. And that is what we're seeing happening in various parts of the world right now, which is very worrying, obviously, not just for LGBT people, but for anyone who gives a shit about human rights. So, to lighten things up a bit, how about we start with the way that LGBT people are portrayed in TV shows and films. Now, if we appear at all, which is no guarantee, it's usually in one of some very constrained roles. So I think what we should do is maybe start with the most innocuous ones and then move towards the most sinister end of the spectrum, just to show you that even at the good end, it's not great, and at the bad end, it's really terrible. So at the most innocuous, there's the kind of quirky best friend type. So this is someone whose unique perspective on relationships proves useful to the typically straight protagonist, especially if they're pursuing some sort of love interest. You know, once the wisdom of the LGBT person in helping them achieve their love interest has been fulfilled, then the LGBT character can kind of fade into the background. You'll note that in general, unless it's an indie film, Hollywood blockbusters, we do not tend to get leading roles. We are not the the heroes of the story because Hollywood has no interest in portraying us as such. But yeah, let's see. Another common way we are deployed in film and TV is as comic relief. So in this case, you may remember tropes like the flamboyant gay or the adamant lesbian, whose behavior in both cases is just a bit too much and thus can serve as something to, if not laugh at, maybe to kind of remark at. It's like, well, they're a bit unreasonable. They can't expect to go on like that and be accepted in society. So it's a way of basically focusing the attention of the typically straight audience on the fact that, gays, they are very different, aren't they? Oh, well, they're funny though, aren't they? In the mid-range, we have things that no longer treat us as comic relief, but as tragic characters. This is the realm of the cautionary tale. So this is basically when narratives try to convince the audience that that being LGBT plus can only lead to tragedy, or at the very least to a sad, lonely, miserable existence, because we can't show LGBT plus people leading happy, fulfilled lives. That might send a terrible message to someone, says somebody, usually a bigot. But it does get worse. There is there's a trope that is seen very often in films, which is the barrier gaze phenomenon. And all this means is that lazy writers disproportionately kill off queer characters, usually in the first half, sometimes in the first like 15 minutes of a film. Mainly, you know, just as a way to advance the plot or maybe to motivate, you know, again, the typically straight protagonist or hero. And this doesn't just happen to LGBT folks, obviously. Ethnic minorities also tend to get the axe very early in the film. So the people who tend to make it to the end of the film are usually the straight white people. If there are any straight white people in the film, this will be one of those that makes it into the final running. But anyway, if you think that's bad, it even gets worse. There is this phenomenon called queer coding of villains. So if you don't know what queer coding is, this just means when Hollywood lacks the backbone, not that it ever had any backbone, Hollywood takes no risks. It's all about the bottom line. How much money can we make? And we don't want to do anything that's really groundbreaking or challenging, because what if we don't make our money back on it? So yeah, what they'll do is, because they want to have their cake and eat it too, on one side, they'll do what we call queer baiting. And this is where they will have characters that are being portrayed deliberately ambiguously to suggest that maybe by their mannerisms, by their vocal patterns, by their gestures, by their physical characteristics, maybe they're not straight. And therefore, look, we're representing LGBT people. Hey, LGBT people, come, you know, watch our films, buy our shows, buy our DVDs, buy our merchandise. without ever actually, you know, getting down and actually stating that this person is definitely, definitely gay. And they don't do that because, on the other hand, they want to be able to sell the film rights abroad and release a foreign cut of the film where they can just tweak some of the dialogue choices and cut a few scenes and therefore remove the scenes that would show that this character seems to be LGBT. And that way they can mollify, you know, other countries that hate LGBT plus people even more than the average one does. So yeah, queer coding of villains is far too common in Hollywood, which just means that the audience spends like the entire running time of the film being encouraged to hate on and hope for the comeuppance or perhaps even demise of a character who, by complete coincidence, I'm sure, just happens to not appear to be straight. And I mean, this is seriously problematic when you think that Disney is notorious for doing this in its animated films. So there's so many Disney films aimed for children, and you think that children soak up whatever old ideas they're exposed to. And unfortunately, that includes really horrible ones like homophobia. So if you think you can spend thousands or tens of thousands of hours watching films, TV shows that kind of treat LGBT plus characters in this fashion and not come away from that with these ideas rattling around in the back of your head, informing how you perceive and treat LGBT people, then you're fooling yourself. And obviously it affects all of us. I mean, it's something that's been used to control LGBT people as well. We watch the same media you do. We see these things too. And it makes us feel like, well, maybe we don't deserve to have an equal place in society. Maybe we are lesser and stuff like this. So it is incredibly pernicious. But anyway, I'm not trying to be hyper serious about this. What I would try to actually make you think about and take away is that if you look at all of these typical portrayals of LGBT plus characters in media, you'll note that none of them are treated like, you know, just regular people who have or even deserve to have an equal chance at finding love, achieving happiness, pursuing a fulfilling career. Instead, there's this clear implication that that being queer is somehow, you know, less desirable than being straight, and that it's only natural that, you know, LGBT plus people are going to suffer more hardships and find less success in life than their cishet counterparts. And I'm here to tell you that it's not natural. It's entirely constructed. In the case of Hollywood, it's constructed by writers and directors. But in society, it's also a construct, which means we can deconstruct it and change the world for the better, which is what I'm trying to do with videos like this. So anyway, I realize I've rabbited on about that for a while. You're probably wondering, okay, I see that there is a media bias, I get that, Zoe, but that affects like 10% of the population. Why should the other 90% of the population care? I mean, why should straight people step up to actively defend LGBT folk when it doesn't really impact them? And I'd say that the answer lies in two key concepts. There's conformity and there's intersectionality. So let's talk about them in turn. So let's see, conformity. I think it's easier just to say that homophobia is not the only pernicious practice that has been bolstered by TV and film and other forms of media well into the 21st century. You would think that we'd grown out of certain really stupid backwards ideas by now, but no, we have to pursue them and continue to indoctrinate the younger generations with the same hateful ideas as things from centuries gone by. So yeah, if you scroll through the stories on any major news site, or look at the comments, never look at the comments, or, you know, heaven help you if you just kind of sit down and consume typical mainstream news channels on TV, you will soon feel this steady drumbeat of conformity. And this is because basically the ruling classes that own all of our media and therefore control the messages we receive want the populace to conform. It makes us easier to control. So they want us to, you know, accept that the status quo is pretty much as good as it's going to get, at least good enough. They want us to internalize the idea that substantive change for the better just isn't feasible and we shouldn't even try. And in the words of one particularly awful dead politician, they want us to accept that there is no alternative. So I'm going to save my rant for, you know, about how the dystopian hellscape that is late-stage capitalism affects all of our lives for another video. But my take-home message at this point is just that the powers that be don't want things to change for the better for you, because things are just dandy for them, okay? They brandish these top-down control structures like the police, like the courts, like the military, because they're aware that any social changes that arise from the ground up, that originate from the people, pose a serious threat to their monopoly on power. So, by extension, hopefully you can see that we are steadily being trained out of deeply exploring or engaging with or even entertaining the idea that we could live a much better life, that things could be, there could be different modes of existence which are equally valid or maybe even better than the ones we're currently laboring under. And I think mainly they certainly don't want the public at large to fully internalize the idea that gender and sexual orientation and race or skin color should have as little to do with your social station in life as, say, your height, your eye color, and your freaking shoe size. But of course, if people got that message, there would be an absolute revolution, and that is not something the ruling classes want to occur, because it's not profitable if the public rises up against you. So let's compare a few different ways that the state actually manages to enforce conformity on the public. One of these is by fostering a myth of exceptionalism. So if you're not familiar with this term, it just means when the state tries to convince its citizens that their way of life, however bleak, however constrained, however difficult, is nonetheless innately better than the way of life pursued in other countries. It has to fool its nationals into believing that, yeah, foreign approaches to our global problems are by nature inferior or misguided and certainly don't need to be tried here at home because, you know, they're just crazy foreigners. You can't pay attention to them. Just remember, we have to fight for our way of life. This is our way of life, and however crappy it is, you should be fighting for it. So yeah, this kind of message is a considerably harder sell if people recognize that humans are pretty much the same the world over, and therefore, yeah, they're foreigners, but they've come up with a good idea and it seems to be working for them. Why can't we try that here, where basically, I know the way we've been doing things forever doesn't seem to be achieving the same results. But yeah, the state does not want you entertaining such thoughts. Similarly, the ruling classes require an endless supply of scapegoats to basically draw the brunt of the public's ire. I mean, most people realize the world we live in is not great. I would go as far as to say pretty fucking awful. If you think about it, the world we could be living in a paradise. We have all these resources. We have enough food to feed every person on the planet. 50% over, but we deliberately destroy and waste food because giving it away isn't profitable, so capitalism doesn't allow that to happen. We have enough accommodation to house every single person that unfortunately sleeps rough on the streets, but again, it's not profitable to do that, so we don't do that. Basically, the myriad ways that capitalism destroys a decent human existence and basically tamps down on the potentiality of the human race is shocking. And the fact that it's managed to get away with it for several centuries, I mean, it's obviously coming to an end now. One way or the other, the lack of sustainability in late-stage capitalism is showing as it starts to burst at the seams. But unfortunately, we need to kind of like take matters into our own hands before it does. But anyway, I think my main thrust on this point is you need scapegoats to cause the public to not realize that the true enemy is the ruling class that hates all of us. And while the state can obviously always deploy the military-industrial complex to manufacture foreign foes for us to despise, it still needs to be able to control the people on at home. And an effective means of preventing us from, you know, organizing and, you know, organizing up and challenging existing power structures is to basically sow divisions, both philosophical and political, that fragment the population so that we can't unify and we can't threaten the power structures that currently exist. And by far the easiest way to do this is to basically just get people fighting over the fate and status and rights of marginalized groups in society, like the poor, the homeless, as we said earlier, the disabled, ethnic minorities, and you guessed it, LGBT plus people as well. Finally, I'd say that another way that they desperately want to continue, have the people conforming to the status quo, is due to a concept called social reproduction. And this is, just means the vast and largely unpaid category of human endeavor, whereby new people are brought into existence and then raised and prepared to fulfill roles that will be useful to the ruling classes, to capitalism, to go and to, you know, serve the state. It doesn't matter what they might have wanted to do with their lives. You need to be a good little citizen and do what you're told. And in this case, if you look at the history of capitalism, it could never have arisen in the first place, and certainly would not have survived for as long as it has, if at any point it had been required to actually pay for all of these services. Now, I'm sure it'll come as no surprise to people that the great majority of social reproduction is performed by women, and therefore is immediately devalued and taken for granted. So women are basically expected to provide the sort of people-making as a free service to capital, and to never ever expect to be properly compensated for all the hours and effort that they put into that. So it's hardly any accident that here we are, maybe about a century on from the advent of universal women's suffrage in many countries, and we still live in a world that is a total entrenched patriarchal form of governance. It's because it's profitable, people. It's certainly profitable to exploit the free labor of women, and then to blame them for all sorts of things in society, and then to wonder why women are treated as second-class citizens. But anyway, that's a rant for another time. But it does happily lead us on to my final point. We're getting there. Sorry, I talk a lot. You may have noticed. Maybe that's why you watch these videos. My final point is on intersectionality. So it sounds like a complicated term. It's not too hard to understand. Basically, it's just an acknowledgement that the different aspects of our social and political identities can sometimes intersect, thus the name, intersectionality, to create new forms of discrimination, or indeed to reinforce or exacerbate existing forms of inequality. And another way of looking at it is to recognize that the people can simultaneously benefit from the privilege of belonging to certain groups while simultaneously suffering disenfranchisement or discrimination due to belonging to other groups as well. It's not an either-or situation. You'll sometimes find people getting very butthurt at being accused of having privilege. It's like, I work really hard and I have a hard life and these bad things happen to me. It's like, well, yeah, the bad things happen to you because of capitalism. It hates everybody unless you happen to be part of the 0.1% that owns everything. But yeah, apart from that, you can be both up in a privileged group, like a white guy, and at the same time be in a disadvantaged group, like say a working class person or a person of another ethnicity, and this sort of thing, or a religion. You know, if you're in a minority religion in the region you live in, you might be face discrimination on that basis. So again, it's several things that intersect together and yield sometimes surprising and sometimes very, very predictable results. But anyway, just to give me as an example, I'm obviously white, so I benefit from white privilege, which in my case just means that I live in a country where people of my skin color are, on average, treated better than people of color. And there's no rhyme or reason to it. It's not fair. It just is the way society is structured. And likewise, my profession, I teach undergraduate science at university. That marks me as part of the middle class, so I enjoy certain privileges of belonging to the middle class that aren't afforded to, say, working class people. But on the flip side, I'm female, so I get to enjoy all forms of misogyny, some more subtle than others. And because I'm bi, or, well, technically pansexual, which just means that I'm attracted to people for who they actually are rather than for what genitals they may not possess. This is something society has never forgiven me for, by the way. To top it all off, obviously I'm trans. So yeah, I stand at the intersection of several different forms of discrimination, and so I get to observe these things from an interesting angle. But luckily for me, and this is not true for all trans women, obviously, I'm white, I'm middle class, so I have things that buffer me a bit. So even though I experience these forms of discrimination, I have these privileges, and it's important for people with privilege, even if you only have one or two of them, to basically recognize that you're in a position to stand up for people who are less privileged than you, people who are less mainstream, people who are in more marginalized groups of the population than yourself. So even though as a trans woman, I am definitely part of a very marginalized group, and as I said earlier, very worried that the conservative government in the UK is going to basically make sure that I get arrested if I try to use a woman's toilet, which I've been using like for the past 3 years with no complaints. Lots of women, they obviously know that I'm trans. Nobody cares because guess what? You go into the toilet to use the toilet, wash your hands and leave. It's really not something we need to actually debate. But yeah, I'm in a position that I get to see that I'm discriminated against there, but because I'm white and middle class, I can kind of agitate and be an activist and try to get these messages out in a way that someone who, say, is a person of color or is in a, doesn't have the financial resources that I do, doesn't have the kind of job I do, wouldn't be able to. So this is my message here about intersectionality, is that we have an obligation, if we have some privileges, to use them to help other people who lack those privileges. But anyway, I don't want to belabor this too much. You're probably wondering, has she gone totally off the rails? Wasn't she going to tell us something about how this all connects to LGBT plus allyship? So I'm trying to get there, but let's get there, I promise. We're within minutes. We're within minutes of the target. Just stay with me, people. So let's see, how to sum all this up? I guess, well, here, let's put it this way. When the state wants to mislead us, when the ruling classes want to control us, when the media wants to divide us, it's always queer people who are at the thin edge of the wedge that they try to use to divide us. Or put another way, we're the canaries in the coal mine. You can thank us later. Look, I'm even wearing yellow. But yeah, basically, whenever society begins that slide into fascism or other tyrannical forms of government, ours are some of the very first rights to be taken away, as we are currently seeing in various parts of the world. It's very, very scary. And the reason for this is because we're such an easy target. I mean, only like 1 in 10 people are LGBT+, and only like 1 in 100 are trans or non-binary. So yeah, obviously, and by the way, this is what people mean when you hear people say trans rights are human rights. It's because we're that first domino, and that domino chain that stretches off out of the screen, off the picture. And if we're knocked over, it just continues, and rights can be eroded because each right that's taken away makes it easier for the state or the ruling classes to take away the next rights. And basically what ends up happening is that rights that you hold dear, even if you aren't LGBT+, will eventually be affected. And you could have stopped it by standing with us on this first domino and just preventing that one from being hit in the first place. So yeah, it's a lot easier to stoke hatred against an innocent and already isolated group that only comprises 1% of the human population. So yeah, if you are a state power or a ruling class and you want to start the gradual rolling back of human rights so that you can control the populace better because you realize capitalism is failing and is unsustainable and you're worried about, apart from the bunkers you're building on islands to defend yourself so you can run away after the climate catastrophe begins to really hit home. Yeah, if you want to like kind of milk the system for a few more decades so that you can make it to your death and who cares about the rest of the world or generations after you, you begin by vilifying transgender people, okay? I don't think I can make it any clearer than that. Anyway, I think part of the concept of intersectionality is that all forms of bigotry are interconnected, and studies have shown that individuals who hold prejudices towards one outgroup are typically prejudiced towards several other groups as well. Which again means that no one you care about is safe from eventual persecution. If straight people don't stand up for trans folk now, the hate groups that are currently being dog-whistled by political demagogues and by, you know, the tabloid press will next turn their sights on lesbians, gays, and bisexuals. And after they've dealt with them, then they'll be easier for them to further seek marginalization of other groups like the homeless, like the disabled, like ethnic minorities, and eventually like all women. Because again, as we talked about earlier with social reproduction, women are doing a whole bunch of work that isn't acknowledged, isn't paid for, and basically is just assumed by capitalism, without which this already teetering, crumbling, horrible system would collapse, and we'd actually have to seek out a better world in a more just society. And that is something the ruling elites really, really do not want to happen. So yeah, I guess I should wrap this up. Hopefully it's not hard to see that we are at a pivotal moment in human history. It's a critical juncture, and I know there's a lot of doom about, like, it's hopeless. How are we ever going to get ourselves out of this mess? And indeed, with the people who've seized all of our assets, who've stolen all of our wealth, all of the resources from, you know, 99% of the population so they could hoard it and have incredible lifestyles we can only dream about. It seems hard to believe that we can save our civilization, but it sure as hell isn't going to happen if we continue clinging to the system of, you know, the destructive, exploitative, horrible, human-hating system that is capitalism. So for us to not merely survive the coming century, but to thrive as a species, I think we're going to need to forge a far more equitable, a far more accepting and tolerant society, one that actually protects and empowers all of the people on the planet, just ones lucky enough to be born in the right place at the right time or with the right circumstances or the right skin color. And if we can do that, then by fostering their skills and training them up, we will be able to draw on their strengths later to find a way forward and out of this mess. But if we continue to treat like 99% of the planet and its people as completely disposable or grist for the mill or cogs in the machine, yeah, there's literally going to be no hope for us. So yeah, we can only get there together. And resisting the attempts of our corrupt ruling classes to have us turn on each other and fight each other while they continue to extract all of our resources is absolutely essential. We need to stand up for human rights, and that doesn't mean just the people at the end of the, you know, at the barrel of the gun, which is people like me at the moment. It means everyone. So you need to step up for marginalized groups like LGBT people, like ethnic minorities, like the homeless. All these groups that are vilified because, again, they're easy targets and have a hard time standing up for themselves, we're being used as a distraction to fool you while the state works at taking your rights away too. So yeah, I'm asking you to become an active and preferably vocal ally for LGBT plus people, because if you don't, our voices are not loud enough to be heard over the like roar of hatred that groups that are much better funded than we are and are being controlled, again, by the state, by the media, by the powers that be, to basically drown out our message. And our message is just one of acceptance and tolerance and looking for a better world. We're all trying to do this together. We can help you, but if you allow us to be wiped out, they'll be coming for you next. Or maybe if not next, then the third or fourth down the road. It depends on how many privileged groups you actually happen to be a member of. But anyway, I'm just saying, do something, take this seriously, stand up and start being an activist and an ally. Don't just do it for me, do it for you, do it for your families, do it for your communities, do it for society as a whole, do it for the general good, do it so that we have a chance at actually having a future. All right. I think I've said enough. If you haven't gotten the message, I can't help you. Thanks for watching, and I will see you in another video. Bye-bye. Well, wasn't that fun? If you agree, there's a few things you can do, like click the like button or leave me some feedback as a comment or subscribe if you're not already subscribed to my channel. All of these things help. And if you'd like to move beyond that and support the channel and the videos I do in a more substantive fashion, I've listed a number of sort of donation options here on this final slide. Right, I think that's about it, and I'll look forward to seeing you all in future videos. Take care.